श्रीनादि गुरु गुहो जयति जयति श्रीनादि गुरु गुहो जयति जयति श्रीनंदनाथोकमिति संततो तुदिनि भज श्री चिदानंदनाथोकमिति संततो तुदिनि भज श्री नातादि गुरु
Welcome to the third episode of this series, Explore, brought to you by MOPA Foundation, that Vignesh and I are putting together. For this episode, we are going to discuss the music and art of Srimati D.K. Pattamad. My first introduction to her music was way back in 1999, when I was learning from Srimati Sulochana Pattabhiraman. She used to live on Eldams Road, where a couple of buildings away from her home was this shop that invariably had all the Sangeeta and Nindreko cassettes of that time. And I remember very clearly that it was 99 and I was learning Kavava. And while I was browsing through the catalog on the way back home from one of her classes, I came across a cassette of D.K. Pattamad presenting compositions of Papanasam Shivan, where it had about 11 or 12 compositions and one of them was Kavava. I remember listening to that tape over and over again, and learning all the compositions from that and singing it to my teacher and getting it corrected. The fascinating thing for me was, even till today, if I hear someone sing it at a concert or if, say, I am practicing it at home, the way she's sung it has had such a deep impact in me because of the way she presents compositions itself, let alone the fact that it didn't have ragam, nirval, swaram in that particular cassette. It was purely a presentation of compositions, but it was so wholesome that it left such an impact on a young student's mind like me. And the great aspect about her rendering compositions is not just that it was compositions of Papanasam Shivan, which were fairly newer compared to, say, compositions of Muthuswami Dikshitar or Thyagaraja. Irrespective of which composition she rendered, the discipline was always there. It was very structured, it was put together beautifully, and you would see a constant flow from beginning to end where there was one complete picture by the end. And that, I think, is a great quality of her music, which I think was the core of everything else she did around.
She had a very unique voice. It was much lower in pitch than her contemporary women singers, and because of which you could perceive a certain weightiness in her voice. It is also because of her ayutam. I don't know a word in English to actually describe this Tamil word ayutam. You can actually call it weightiness. There was this quality to her voice, and that was accentuated because of her lower pitch also to the audience.
When we speak about D.K. Pattamad's voice, like Vignesh said, it was, the pitch was much lower than most of her contemporaries, yes. But just in terms of voice texture, you wouldn't think of D.K. Pattamad's voice as what was considered then the ideal voice for Carnatic music. So it would have been very easy for people to dismiss her, saying, you know, she doesn't have a great voice, or, you know, this voice is not suited for Carnatic music. But what makes her voice entirely special, in my personal opinion, is the fact that she understood the emotion of her voice, the quality of her music, and brought the two together seamlessly. Where when you heard her present a composition, or just sing a raga alapana, or just sing karves on Shadjamam when she's singing a ragam like Todi or Kalyani, it sounds beautiful because she understood the greatness and the uniqueness of her voice, how the two can be put together beautifully. And I think we've all benefited from the fact that she managed to do that, because it, I think, showed the world that there are multiple different ideas and textures of what a good voice can be, and it is only up to the artist in terms of how they choose to use the voice, based on which it does justice to the art form and to their own self as an artist. In fact, if you look at the earliest gramophone recordings that she released, there's a wonderful recording of Eppadi Padinaro, which I think is at about 4.5 or 5. when she was in, say, her late 20s. But by the time she was 40, she was already singing in a pitch that was 3, which is E, which is extremely unnatural, because by then the male pitch was around 2, 2.5, and the female pitch was at 5.5 or 6. So it was kind of in between, which meant that then the same songs that you heard in the voices that you were familiar with automatically had a different tone and flavor to when you were listening to it in a different pitch that we were not used to in hearing a voice. So that automatically added a very different dimension to her own music. What is interesting is also around, I think, 1960s is when her brother D.K. Jayaraman started singing along with her. Though he sang in 1 or say lower in B, when he sang with her, he would sing in her octave but in 3 or 4, which then also brings the question, did she drop her pitch to also be able to facilitate him sing along? But I don't think that that would have been a good enough reason for her to drop her pitch, because when you listen to her sing, her voice range seems complete in E. Even the concerts after D.K. Jayaraman stopped singing along with her, when you listen to her sing, she still maintains that same pitch. And for someone to drop their pitch from G all the way down to E, the voice is not malleable enough to be able to, I think, expand the entire range in both these pitches that are starkly far away from each other. So the fact that that suited having D.K. Jayaraman also sing along was an added bonus, because of which we heard some lovely concerts that the two of them also sang together. But the beautiful part is how she embraced that drop in pitch and the sound of her voice at that pitch that then molded what she sang at that point, which I think is a great quality for musicians to have, because that then also brings together a different understanding of your own music and what your music can move and change around to be depending on small factors like, say, the pitch or who you're singing along with and other things that are bound to change.
If you also look at the pace of her music, it is generally madhyamakaram. It's not just the pace of the songs that she sings, or whether it's a fast song or a slow song or a big song or a small song, the general pace of her music was madhyamakaram. She sang her niraval in madhyamakalam, swarams in madhyamakalam. Even if you look at her ragam development, her phrasings will be accentuated with this kampita gamakam, which gives you a sense of this madhyamakalam.
Sense of movement.
Movement, yeah. In madhyamakalam in her music.
Absolutely. In fact, even when she sings slightly slower paced compositions like, say, Soundarajam or Chetashri Balakrishnam or compositions like that, it's very interesting because of how tight her patantaram is and how filled up it is in terms of the talam. You will find her syllables always falling on the beat. So which means that there's very little movement space within that, which I think is a very unique quality to her, because in most other cases when you see that the speed is dropped, then automatically the placements of the syllables, the freedom that's taken in terms of how the alav is always a little more freer. Exactly, exactly. But you won't find that with hers, because of which even when she's singing slower, you will still feel a meter to it, which I think is a very interesting way to look at her madhyamakalam, that's driven by kala pramanam as opposed to not just the general pace at which it is sung, where the tightness of her rendering gives you the sense of madhyamakalam even if it's a slower pace song.
கண்டம் ஊரிதா பகவை புல்தம் கும்போரு கசி கண்டம் ஊரிதா பகவை புல்தம் Bye.
And she never sang a song, a slower paced song. You know, she never sang it slower than, you know, what she thought was the ideal Kala Pramanam for that song. It's also the accent of her music. While even when she's singing slow songs, the accenting of the gamakas, the kampita gamaka, the altam is what gives you that sense of Madhyama Kalam. Even in those large, big compositions that are generally perceived as slow.
Yeah. So those anchor points actually keep helping in a very interesting way. Interestingly, if you look at her concert structure, it was very close to the Kacheri Paddhati as we know it today. But the interesting facet about that was you saw a variety of compositions, a variety of composers, languages in her concerts, and you would also find a larger number of compositions covered across a concert than what was normal at that time. For example, in the 50s and 60s, if you look at a concert list, you will find almost 17 to 20 compositions, which is quite a lot for that period of time. But what is interesting to note is when we actually sit and listen to the concert, you don't feel like you've heard so many compositions. You feel that the balance between Manodharma and the composition is very balanced. And also we have to understand that because of the Kala Pramanam of her singing, what would take say 7 or 8 minutes today was a 2.5-3 minute song. So which means that the duration of each of the compositions she presented was also a lot crisper and tighter, which meant that there was more time to also explore other facets of Manodharma. The phenomenal part about this is she can make you feel complete by just singing a composition, or the same composition in another concert she would present with ragam, niraval and swaram, and it would still feel complete. So it's great that there was a lot of space within her concert music for Manodharma Sangeeta and for Kalpita Sangeeta, which I think is a great balance in her that a lot of us really can learn from.
Right, like you said, the composition singing itself, when she sings a composition, there is so much integrity in it, there is so much
intensity.
Yeah, intensity also. And discipline that you hear the same composition in multiple concerts, right from the sangatis, the repetitions of the sangatis, the way the sangati is sung, the way the voice is given to the sangatis, everything is beautifully just so disciplined.
Yeah.
She also, along with many other compositions from many composers, she I think is one of the people who brought to the front many Dikshtar, Mutsvam Dikshtar compositions like Srinathadi Guru Goho Jayati, Saundara Raja Mashreye, Pahimam Ratnachala, Tyagaraja Yoga Vibhavam, and many more.
Anandeshwarena, Mamav Pattabhirama.
Right.
So many compositions.
So she brought these compositions into mainstream concert singing and presented them with a lot of elaboration with ragam, niraval, swaram, and popularized them so that all of us can learn it now and all of us know these kirtans because of her music.
Absolutely. And also most of these compositions were considered not suitable for kacheri music at that point. A lot of those songs, because of how languorous in a way they were in terms of length and in terms of musical movement, but then to present that in a concert and to get people to enjoy them was something that she established, because of which now we sing far more longer and complicated and slower compositions that people have gotten used to. So I think it's also creating that mindset of saying, look, I enjoy singing this and I want to give this to you and I believe you will enjoy it as well. So that conviction is very strong in her music.
So when we speak about Srimati B.K. Pattamal's Patantaram, there were many layers to it. Not just the way she sang her kirtanams with total intensity and discipline and integrity. She also brought to the fore many kirtanams that were not in vogue in those days, like Raksha Bettare, Kancha Dalaya Dakshi, Chani Todi in Harikamboji. She was known for singing Harikamboji beautifully. Sadari na 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 Sadara na 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 Sadara na 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 She also brought to the fore many compositions of Papanasam Shri, Papanasam Shivan, many patriotic. She was known for singing many, many patriotic songs and in various languages. She also had a wide repertoire of compositions, different compositional forms such as Varnams. I've heard a recording of her singing the Dayanidhi Varnam of Sri Shama Shastri.
Begada
Varnam. Varnams, Tirupugals, Kavadi Chindas.
She also sings Tasaveri Varnam, Danyasi Varnam.
Right, Kamalakshi, the Yadukal Kamalakshi.
Exactly. And also I think Pagavari Hamsadhoni Varnam.
Exactly.
Yeah.
So, there are many, many compositions that she kind of brought into the mainstream. Not only Kirtanas, but like this Varnams, Tirupugals, Kavadi Chindas, Kuil Patis. And of course, when you look at her Ragam Thanam Palavi singing also, like you said, it's very easy to listen to, and that also has that same kachidam and discipline of a composition that she sings. So that speaks to that style of singing, that
overall discipline.
And she's also known to have learnt from any source that was available. There was an innocent curiosity about her. She valued good music wherever she saw it, and she took whatever she thought was good for her music from it without any fuss or without any ego coming in between. So that was a really nice quality about her music and her personality that we all can learn a lot from. She also had a very beautiful way of singing Tamil compositions. I think it's in the way you enunciate the syllables in the language. There was a very musical quality about the way she pronounced these syllables, and you know, had a certain affinity towards the language also, which came out in the way she sang any Tamil composition, be it Shanti Nilava Vendum, Nanur Vilayattu Bommaya, Eppadi Paadinaro, all the Papanasam Shivan Kritis. It was something that was very beautiful about her singing of Tamil compositions. Patantaram, again, it another layer of Patantaram is in the way it is presented. Even though the Sangati structure and the song structure is static and you sing it like you have learnt it, there is a fluidity in the way you present it, in the way you interpret it and present it. Srimati D.K. Patamal, I think, was brilliant at this. So generally when you sing Varnam in a Kacheri, when you reach the charanam part of the varnam, you would shift gears and go into the second speed. This shift in speed for her would be according to the ragam and according to her own voice.
Yeah.
It's beautiful in the way she interpreted the ragam for her voice and determined the speed according to both these factors.
Yeah.
right? Generally, there is a Kala Pramanam for the ragam also, but to understand that in your own voice, to sing it with that aitam, with that accenting, and to understand to sing and to understand what speed to sing based on what you are going to do with that composition.
Yeah.
Also, for example, when she sang a varnam and she wanted to sing swarams in that varnam, the shift in gear from the Pallavi Anupallavi Mukteswaram to the Charanam will be at a different pace than when she just wants to sing the varnam and finish it.
Let's now look at the Raga Alapana singing of D.K. Pattamad. One striking feature of her Alapanas is that it's entirely phrase oriented, and you will never find any unnecessary phrases in her Raga Alapana. Every phrase would be beautifully connected one to the other, and what comes next would be determined by the flow of the previous phrase, and it would be entirely natural to the aesthetic sound of that ragam, which I think is extremely important. Trying to explore the multiple different facets of the ragam and singing a 30 minute alapana is one aspect of it, but then after doing all of that, to find the essence and to be able to give that essence every single time you sing is an entirely different ball game. And I think she was a master at that. If you look at some of the raga alapanas that she sung, especially for Pallavis, you will find her exploring the raga alapana in, say, different stages. But after the violins turn, when she again explores the same stage, every phrase would still be filled with essence. Every phrase would still belong, but none of the phrases would have been a repetition of what she sang the previous time in that range. So, which shows that she had a huge range of ideas for each section, but what she chose to sing at which juncture was determined by the flow on that particular day, which I think is a great quality. Of course, it's no secret that she had a great affinity towards ragas like Danyasi, Mukari, Begada, Sahana, Surati, and all these ragams. But you would also find detailed explorations by her in ragas like Vachaspati, Simendra Madhyamam, Madhyamavati, Chakravaham. But you will also find explorations by her in ragas that aren't sung too often, like say Jayanta Sena or a beautiful 7-minute Pushpalatika Raga Alapana before Ikanainana. There's a recording of her singing Raga Alapana Nadanama Kriya. In ragas like Manirangu, there is of course the famous Ragam Thanam Pallavi in Manirangu that she sung. In ragas like Jagan Mohini, so which means that she's also explored a lot of offbeat ragams that weren't necessarily explored in detail at that point of, say, the graph of Carnatic music. Mm-hmm. So when we talk about these rare ragas that she's explored, it's fascinating that she's used them in Ragam Thanam Pallavis, which require a more deeper understanding of the ragam for it to be able to shine through alapana, neraval, swaram, thanam, and to also be able to take the weight of being able to sustain multiple different speeds, trikalams, etc. So the fact that she explored ragam thanam pallavis and ragams like Manirangu, Jagan Mohini, Danyasi, Harikamboji is a treat to listen to. Of course, she is sung Ragam Thanam Pallavis in Shankarabharanam and Thodi and Kalyani. Kalyani seems to be her favorite. She is sung Kalyani in almost every second or third concert, but multiple different compositions. Again, shows her, the vastness of her repertoire. But to sing Nadapallavis with tricky edupu, sometimes filled with a lot more words in these kind of ragams like Manirangu, Jagan Mohini is, I think, a phenomenal achievement in just how deep you can understand a ragam and what are the possibilities of even a ragam that we feel is limited in its scope.
And especially in Pallavis, when you look at Pallavis, complex Pallavis in these ragams, singing Neraval to that Pallavi, like playing with the syllables and the ragam and the positions and the complexity of the talam is phenomenal.
Yeah.
That shows how much she actually knew the ragam. So when you look at her Pallavi singing, we have to speak about her Thanam singing. One striking aspect of her Thanam singing is the beautiful usage of the Thanam syllables. In ragams like Thodi, even these ragams like Manirangu and Harikamboji, Danyasi, the usage of Thanam syllables was so appropriate to the pattern of the Thanams that she was singing, to the ragam, the essence of the ragam, the flavor of the ragam was not lost, but the syllabic structure of the thanam was maintained, and she was not just accentuating using vowels, but she was using num tum thanum, those syllables in association with the ragam along with the patterns, and also keeping the essence of the entire structure intact. That was something beautiful. And her thanams were not so much pattern driven. She wouldn't sacrifice the essence of the ragam to incorporate a certain pattern, or you know, to incorporate the form of the thanam. So that is another very important aspect while singing thanam. Yeah. And she beautifully did it in these ragams, which are actually tough to sing thanam in, mm-hmm. like Surati, Danyasi, yeah. Manirangu, Jagan Mohini especially. And it's very easy to slip off into ragam singing rather than thanam singing, right? But she uses the syllables beautifully to maintain that thanam singing form,
yeah.
along with the essence of the ragam.
Yeah. Actually, what is interesting is the Kala Pramanam of her Thanam is very close, actually in hindsight, to the Kala Pramanam of the Pallavi that follows, irrespective of the ragam.
Right.
So, in a very interesting way, she uses the idea or the concept of the Thanam as a bridge between the Raga Alapana and the Pallavi. What is also interesting is the fact that she never sang extensive Thanams, but even if she sang 5 rounds of say 1.5 minutes each, they would have a very clear progression. Each of them would be complete in that particular region,
right.
or around the note in which she was exploring, depending on the ragam. And she would bring it back very beautifully without compromising on, like you said, the structure or the aesthetic sound of the ragam, but at the same time complementing the ragam that preceded it and creating a beautiful flow into the rhythmic structure of the Pallavi. I don't know if she thought about it so much. I mean, in hindsight, now when we listen to it, it seems like one continuous picture. But the fact that she looked at Thanam in a very different way, as a link between these two aspects of the Ragam and Pallavi, is, I think, a beautiful way of looking at the Thanam as well. So that opens out an entirely different exploration structure to the Thanam, as opposed to looking at it as a standalone, rather than looking at it as a bridge between the two, which I think is very exciting as an idea.
Right. And while she explored Ragam extensively in stages, like you said, her Thanam was short and crisp. So that kind of contrast from a certain detail in the Ragam delineation to a detail in the Thanam singing, which actually pays more attention to the form and the pattern along with the Ragam, kind of is a beautiful bridge to the next part, which is the Pallavi, which will again go into rhythmic and musical melodical exploration of the Pallavi and of the Raga. Another aspect of her Thanam singing is that the Thanam will be in one Kala Pramanam from start to end. There is no change in Kala Pramanam of the Thanam when she reaches the higher octave in order to give a certain climax. You don't find that in her Thanam singing, and that I think is an important aspect of her Thanam singing also.
When we look at D.K. Pattamal's Nerval singing, you will find it to be extremely structured in terms of its development, but extremely crisp in rendering, which doesn't always go hand in hand. When you look at a detailed development, you always think of it being a lot more expansive. But the fact that she was able to achieve that structure of giving a wholesome feeling in every single region, while at the same time being extremely crisp in just 2 or 3 avartanams and progressing constantly, is, I think, also an indication of how well she knew the line, the syllables, the words, and how she paired the ragam and the sound of the ragam along with those words, which I think is very important to Nerval. Often we find that the words are tricky or the ragam is tricky, because of which Nerval becomes extremely challenging, which is why a lot of people say that to sing Nerval is like probably the most difficult aspect of Manodharma. But to be able to do that in this structure, but at the same time keep it so tight, is phenomenal. And I think one of the things that drives her Nerval singing is obviously seen in her Nerval of Pallavis.
Right.
The fact that she was able to sing Nervals like this for Kirtanams, let's say if it's something like Ramanatham Bajeham in Kumara Guru Guha Mahitam or some other composition like that.
Kumara Guru Guha Mahitam Kavi Brunda Disamutam Kumara Guru Guha Mahitam Kavi Brunda Disamutam
Or Raksha Betare Sangeeta Priya, you will find that her adherence to the syllable and to the meter of the line is constant. You will never find her taking a liberty of half avartanam and singing a ragam, or using just Sangeeta as a word and filling a few avartanams and then coming back to the meter. The meter is constantly always there, almost like how you are expected to sing Nerval for a Pallavi. So it's kind of wonderful that the way she sang Nerval naturally also yielded to her singing Nerval in Pallavi, which made it that much more, I guess, easier for her to handle those different syllable placements and to handle the complexity of the arithmetic within a given line when she sang a Pallavi, which is a wonderful way, because when we sing Nerval, we are always taught to take liberties with it. What are all the liberties you can take? So then when you're asked to sing a Pallavi with all of these restrictions where you have to follow something, you feel like you're being restricted.
Yeah.
But if you were taught to sing Nerval with that discipline already, then singing a Pallavi is a natural extension of that.
Right. You keep the syllables in place, in position of the talam, yeah. and you sing nerval for that.
And you follow the meter strictly.
Right.
There's no freedom that's taken. So to be able to give you the essence of the ragam without being able to give you raga phrases or what they call sakhi nerval in between is that much more difficult to establish.
Yeah, to in so you just have that much of a space between the syllables to explore the ragam that you are singing.
Yeah.
In that kala pramanam, well, mind it, her kala pramanam was madhyama kalam.
Yeah.
Even her kirkal nerval was generally at a faster space than what we see today.
Yeah.
So in that small space between the syllables to keep that syllabic, if I can say, the syllabo melodic structure, to keep that intact and give us a flavor of the ragam, explore the ragam, and to actually try and create something at that in that small space is something that is very difficult, and she did it brilliantly. This strict adherence to a certain structure and meter is also seen in her swaram singing. If you listen to her singing Kirkala swarams, the Madhyama Kalam is maintained. There is not much karvai generally, but the karvais are in accordance to the ragam, where there is Kampita Gamakam, and where she sees there is a small avenue for giving a karvai or exploring the ragam at that point while singing the swarams. Otherwise, generally when you listen to her swarams, you will be hearing swarams continuously in that madhyama kalam with different patterns. Even when she sings male kala swarams, if you can try and observe, you'll see that there is not much karvai. There will be a lot of karvai-less continuous swarams filled into the avartanam, which is extremely difficult to do. To sing kalpana swarams in that way without a gap in every avartanam and also extending it to one or two to more than one avartanam is extremely difficult. She did it effortlessly. She also sang a lot of tishram in her swaram singing. Especially if you hear the Jagan Mohini Ragam Tanam Pallavi, she would have sung male kala tishram. And effortlessly, different patterns with different edipas. One edipa will be in kala edam, one edipa will be after three aksharams, one edipa will be adhunnu minnadi, atita edipula. And brilliantly, she would have sung male kala tishram swarams. Her general kala pramanam itself was fast. I'm reiterating this again and again because her general kala pramanam was fast. To sing something faster than that in another nadai, like tishra nadai, is something phenomenal, and singing variety in it.
And at that point, I don't think there were too many musicians who did male kala tishram while singing swaram in a ragam tanam pallavi, where the talam was already
complicated.
So that is one aspect of it. The other aspect of her swaram singing also is the fact that there was a constant between avartanams. If you look at the meter, it would follow even if she's singing Kirkala Swaram. What we all have gotten used to today is this thing called Odukkarudu, Odukkal. If it's 1, 2, 3, 4, her swarams will be on 1, 2, 3, 4, even if it's Kirkalam. It's not 1, 2, 3, 4, or you know, like small shifts like that we so freely do today, you will never find in her swaram singing. And she never uses pa or sa as a nyasa at all, which we do a lot today. Most of the corpus we do today are not on the notes that are, let's say, the jiva swara of the raga, but more so on pa or sa, because you know it's familiar, you can kind of have one pattern and replicate that pattern on multiple ragas.
Easy landing point.
Exactly. But with her, you will find very rarely that she takes even a pause on pa or sa. The pause is generally on the note where the raga can kind of take the pause in, where there's a gamaka or there's a natural pause there according to the flow of the raga. Mm-hmm. So that is a beautiful aspect of swaram singing, where it's not driven by what the end goal is, but as opposed to what the raga kind of dictates.
Right.
She's extremely aware of what she's singing at that moment. So it's an ongoing process, rather than, you know, when you think of swaram singing, you think of the ending end point and you want to land up there.
And
you, right, and you steer your swaram according to that, but that's not happening over here.
Yeah. When you look at the Pallavi as a separate component, there are multiple different things that you can do with the idea of the Pallavi, and I think she explored all of that in many different ways. If you look at the variety in Thalam, she's sung Pallavis in many different complicated Thalams. She sung Nada Pallavis, she sung Dvinada Pallavis, where the first half of the Thalam in Adi Thalam is Tishra Nada, the second half is Kanta Nada. Then if you look at various different Yeduppus, in terms of starting before Samam or starting 5/6 of the Tisra Nadai, she's done all of that. If you look at, let's say, just Neraval Pallavis that are very small in structure but have a very interesting takeoff point, she's done that as well. If you see Pallavis that kind of don't naturally yield to Neraval singing, that are filled with words, where the Trikalam becomes that much more complicated, because the faster you go, the more syllables you will have to say in a shorter duration of time. She's done that. So in terms of what she's achieved in Pallavi singing is phenomenal. She's explored all of this. You will find her sing Nadapallavis in ragas like Todi, Danyasi, Kedara Gowla, Mukhari, where then the layer of complexity is more, because you then bring in the rakti nature of the raga and kind of overlay that on an already existing complex nada pattern of the thala, which then means that how well you know the ragam becomes that much more important. So that is also something that she did. If you look at some of her Pallavis, she's also created a lot of new interesting Pallavis. She also sings a lot of Pallavis where the words are taken from existing compositions, like Neerajakshi, Kamakshi, or
Palinchukamakshi, Mama Pattabhirama. These are the Pallavis that she has taken from Kirtanams and tuned them.
Mama Pattabhirama.
If you look at the tuning of her Pallavi also, you will see that it generally covers an entire octave. It doesn't matter where it starts. Suppose it starts at the Mandrasthayi Nishadam, it goes up to the Madhyasthayi Nishadam and comes back. So that one octave or sometimes even more. So her exploration of the raga in that composition itself is very complete, if you want to say that. And she composed in a way that the ardhis in her Pallavi would be generally a combination of 4-4 or
2-6
or something like that, where generally for creating impact we split the 8 as 3 and 5 or 3 and 3 or 5 and 3. So that creates an impact. Generally the 3s and the 5s being odd numbers creates a certain syncopation and impact, but she generally used ardhis and split the 8 as 4 and 4, 2 and 6 in even numbers and still created that impact, yeah, of a certain punch and an ending, and that an ardhi generally gives you.
Yeah.
So that's another aspect of her Pallavi composition and singing. So when you look at her Pallavi singing, she knows her structure very, very clearly. The way she sings her Pallavi also, the syllables are in position, the gaps are perfectly clear, everything is sung perfectly. And I think it's extremely important for a student of music to know the line completely in and out for that student to sing Nerval. To be able to sing Nerval in any line, you need to internalize that line. And in Srimati D.K. Pattamal's music, be it a Kirtanam or a Pallavi, the line, the every syllable, every gap, every modulation in the melody, in the raga was also internalized, and that's what I think made that Nerval singing, even in complex talas, pallavis, so effortless for us to listen to.
Definitely.
That's a beautiful aspect of her Nerval singing also, that comes out in her Ragam Tanam Pallavis.
Given how Ragam Tanam Pallavis were being presented at that point, to have someone like D.K. Pattamal present a Pallavis with an entirely different mindset to how a Pallavi can be presented, with her own flavor that only she could have brought in, has been a breath of fresh air from which a lot of other branches of different types of singing Pallavis have come off. So that's a great contribution from someone like her. When we think of musicians who have had a long career where, you know, it spanned multiple different decades, apart from just a performance, you will invariably find that they've contributed in multiple different ways. So if you look at D.K. Pattamal, for example, it's no secret that she was a wonderful teacher. She's taught so many students, and you hear from so many people who learn from her that she teaches compositions the same way she taught somebody else 30 years ago. So that discipline is something that stayed with her throughout her life, in her music, with her art, and that is a wonderful quality that we as students need to learn from teachers, where when we pass it down, we have a certain responsibility in terms of how it is passed down, and we hold that responsibility. If you also look at her foray into film singing, she sang in a number of films when she was young, and a lot of them were huge hits. Of course, I've heard that she used to have a rule in place that she wouldn't sing duets. That if suppose it was a song that required a male and a female character, then she would shift her own voice to match the emotion of both, which I think is a wonderful facet of a musician to be able to do that. Of course, she's sung a lot of different Tamil songs, set a lot of it to tune, set a lot of Bharatiya songs to tune. When we actually look at her films, for example, Thyagabhumi, in which Papanasam Shivan acted and was the music director of, has some legendary songs by D.K. Pattamal. It also has Bharata Punya Bhumi. If you look at Naam Niruvar as a movie, that had Aaduvome Pallu Paaduvome, which is again a song that everyone knows, and also Vetri Ettu Dikkum. Bharata Samudayam Vargave is in Varkai, and Nad Shedithidavum is in Vanasundari. So even in the kind of songs that she chose to sing in films, you can see that there is a clear fervor of patriotism in the songs that she wanted people to listen to in her voice. Even in the songs that she actually tuned, you will find that The Bharatiyar songs that she popularized, set to tune, had a lot of themes, different themes, but of course patriotism was also one of the strong themes. Thai Mani Kodi Parir, for example, that she tuned. She also chose some very interesting ragams to tune in. Like, for example, she chose a raga like Tilang for the words of Shanti Nilava Vendum, which would not probably be the first ragam that comes to anyone's particular mind. But now it's become so popular and legendary that you can't think of those words in any other tune. So she set a lot of compositions like that to tune. Shanti Nilava Vendum was by Setu Madhavarao, of course. There's a wonderful composition in Sindhu Bhairavi, Shanta Ahimsa Murte, which is by Mayuram Vishwanatha Shastri, if I'm not wrong, from his book called Samaya Samarasa Kirtanegal, which has a number of compositions about themes like this. And she's the only one who seems to have sung that song. There's unfortunately no recording, but fortunately she's taught it to a few people, because of which we now have access to that beautiful song. So there's a lot of work in an artist's life that happens like this. Of course, she's popularized Eppadi Paadinaro. That's one of my favorite tracks of hers, where from an old 78 RPM recording, where there is a very short 40 second alapana of Karnataka Devagandhari, but that's the most complete alapana I've heard, where it kind of covers the entire emotion of that ragam. And at that point, it feels like a natural transition into the song. It's wonderful to see also the evolution process of a musician, the different ways in which they contribute. And given that she was a staunch believer in the Gandhian way of life, her rendition of Mohana Gandhi in Yamuna Kalyani, when Gandhi passed away, is still spoken about by many of my old family members today. They still remember that so fondly. When you also look at the risks that she took in using her voice to support the freedom movement. There are stories that say that she was in risk of being jailed for singing certain songs, for singing in certain political gatherings that spoke about the need for a freedom movement in India. The fact that she was fearless and a woman of the 1930s and 40s, where, you know, there were certain expectations of how you should be. Mm-hmm. The fact that she was so free in what she wanted to do, completely had belief and conviction in what she chose to do, and did it without any thought, speaks volumes about her character, about her belief in the art form, and about what she believes her purpose is, which is to lend her voice to anything that she believes has reason. And at that point, freedom struggle is by far the biggest struggle that every Indian would have been facing. Yes. And to say that, you know what, I believe that my voice needs to support this, and to come out and do that so bravely, is, I think, one of the greatest things that a musician could have done.
Of course, you can actually relate her voice with the voice of patriotism at that point in time. And she was way ahead of her times in this way, to actually do something because of belief in it, to overcome all odds. I'm sure there might have been resistance with her family, absolutely, with her friends, with the Carnatic music field.
Absolutely.
To overcome all these hurdles and do something just because of sheer conviction, yeah, is something phenomenal, especially for a woman in that time.
Yeah. And one of the unfortunate things is, because she was such an expert in Pallavi singing, for example, we often label D.K. Pattammal as being a Pallavi expert, where she sang complicated Pallavis that weren't done by women at that point. Or we say, you know, you listen to her sing, you know, you have this patriotic fervor. But her music was beyond all of these things. These were important aspects of her music, but only a part of the larger spectrum of what her music represented.
Yeah, I don't think it should be belittled to a point wherein she is just doing this to shatter glass ceiling, or, you know, to overcome male bastion. No, it was a part of her personality.
Yeah.
It was a part of her music. It was a part of her conviction. It was a part of who she was as a person. And that is just phenomenal.
Yeah, and the fact that she was able to be herself, and where she was so good at what she did, that beyond a point, people had no other choice but to accept,
but
it.
To accept it.
And I think that is the true power of art. That is the true power of will. and of conviction, which I think is abundant
in her music, and she was a trendsetter in every way.
Yeah, and not to say, not to belittle her achievement of what she managed to do at that time, because of which she is created multiple different paths for so many women today.
Yes.
Not just her. If you take artists like Brinda Mukta, M.L. Vasanthakumari, M.S. Subbalakshmi, all of them, the service that they've done for the art form through their music is not just specific to their performance, but to the fact that by what they were able to achieve, they've created multiple opportunities, avenues for people to follow in their path and to create their own paths today.
For generations to follow in that path.
Absolutely.
for women musicians. All these musicians of that time, D.K. Patamal, Brinda Mukta, M.S. Subbalakshmi, M.L. Vasanthakumari, they not just sang to their conviction and overcame barriers at that time, but they also created opportunities, created paths, and were trendsetters for the future generations of all women singers to come, and we can see the fruits of their efforts today.
Absolutely. And I think that speaks volumes about how a musician should lead their life. It's not just about performance, it's not just about getting on stage and singing concerts and going back home. It's about all the different things that you do, that you believe in, where over a period of time you contribute to the art form in multiple different ways. And I think B.K. Patamal is a wonderful example of a service of life in music in multiple different ways, whether it was teaching, whether it was performing, whether it was lending her voice to the patriotic independence movement, whether it was doing things that women weren't supposed to do at that point and overcoming odds. It is such a beautiful story, and it's such an inspiring story for musicians like us, where we then are forced to think about what we are doing with our art form and what more we can do to kind of do justice to all the sacrifices of the artists before us, because of which we are enjoying the privilege today.
Yes, of course. And when we work on such projects, it is a reminder for us about the contributions of these musicians and how to use them as inspiration in our own music and our own journey, as to how we can contribute to art, how we can use our art to contribute to society. And it is, of course, great fun going back to listening to all these recordings with Ritvik and analyzing it and arguing over it. And,
yeah, and actually also realizing, without knowing subconsciously at that age,
exactly,
how much we've taken from these recordings and how little parts of that have become part of our music that,
exactly,
we don't actually realize until we revisit.
Exactly. And revisiting it now, when you have become a little, when we have become a little more aware of what we are doing,
yeah,
that kind of reinforces what we have taken from this music, and also inspires us to think about how we are singing and what we are doing with our music. So with that, we come to an end with this episode of Explore, where we look deeper into the music of Srimati D.K. Patamal. So we are looking forward to the next episode. Please stay tuned. Thank you.
Thank you.
அடைந்து விட்டோம் ஆடுவோமே பள்ளி பாடுவோமே ஆனந்த சுதல் திறம் அடைந்து விட்டோம் ஆடுவோமே எங்கும் சுதந்திரம் என்பத பேச்சு எங்கும் சுதந்திரம்